सो नॉट येट.
Okay. So, where did we leave yesterday? Where did we stop? Anyone? Anyone remembers? Asked
मून
where we stopped yesterday.
सर मून
Yeah.
लैंडिंग.
Moon landing. Yeah, moon landing. We were landing on moon, right? We were trying to land on moon. Okay, so what I'll do is I'll start from the same program. And we'll try once more, like if we can, successfully land with the speed less than, 5 meter per second. It'll be negative, right? So minus, because it's going down. It's a decent. We'll see how it works, right? Let us try. It's falling. The speed is increasing because it's accelerating motion. And hopefully by 4,000 or so, I'll turn on the thrusters. All right, so now the speed is coming down, minus 150, 140, 130, 120, and boom, 101, right? So we crashed with 101 meter per second speed, which is, hello?
Sorry, sir. Presentation is not shared, I think.
Okay, just a second. Okay, so
Yes, sir. Now it is
now
visible.
it's visible. Huh? Yeah, I'm sorry. All right. So this is what I was showing. We can, try once more and see at what speed do we land finally. And yeah, let us see if we succeed again. Maybe 30 seconds more and. Yeah, so by 5,000 I'm turning on the thrusters and it is now speed is reducing 130, 120, 100, 90, 80, 70, 60, 50, 40. We want to bring it down to 5 or less. Right now it is going up. All right, so we'll have to reduce the thrust. Okay, we'll try to keep it around 5. Okay, between 5 and 10 would be the best thing, but we are losing the tank, fuel as we go down. Okay, we'll try to keep it within the check. Yeah, now we'll try to keep it below 5. Let's see if we succeed. Yeah, I'm trying to keep it between 0 and 5. Oh, just right, just now. This is okay. This is just a game, right? You can play it, but we are talking about the programming part. Am I audible and visible as well, right? Just keep me
Yes,
updated
sir.
in case something goes wrong.
Yes, sir.
This is how we land. And now I want to put. Now see, this is a ready-made program. Somebody has made it. LabVIEW has provided it for learning, and I'll explain how we can simply edit the program and make something new in it. Suppose in this program, there is no message at the end. Like when we stopped at minus 6.03. So we want to have some dialogue which tells that, oh, you crash landed, or okay, you successfully landed, within the desired speed limit, or something like that. So now imagine, a program like this in VB or C++ or some other programming language would require maybe 20 lines of codes. And we want to do the same thing here. All we have to do is go to the block diagram. This is all the program, right? That entire program is here. It's very simple. And you see, this is the speed. Now, this is you. I mean, you can double click and go to that terminal. So this is the speed. All you have to do is take one. Now, this is the while loop, right? The while loop is running. The while loop stops. While loop stops when the altitude becomes zero. So at the time when we come out of the loop, when the altitude becomes zero, we get the speed, right? And we can have an indicator here as well, create an indicator. It can be a graphical indicator or numeric indicator. We are just doing it for temporary purpose, so we'll take a numerical indicator. Okay, now what we want to do is we want to compare this and see whether this is less than minus five or not, right? Less than, or it's like less than five or not. So we can go to the comparison palette, and so is the speed, well, it is in negative speed. So it, if the speed is less than less or equal. So if this speed is less than or equal to, this speed is less than or equal to, create constant, minus five. But if this is, because see, this is the speed it is showing, right? 6.03 is the latest value. So 6.03, if minus 6.03 is less than minus five, that's what we'll ask. Less than minus five. If this is true, then we have crash landed. So we just want to put a dialog box that tells that, so we can go to dialog box, yeah, dialog and user interface. We can have one button dialog, two button dialog, three button dialog, depending on what we want to do, right? Prompt user, display message, something like this. These are the, okay, these are Express VIs, and we will explain what Express VIs mean. But we can simply put a dialog box like this. If this is true, so we'll take a case structure. This is a case structure. Okay. If this is true, that means this is the value at the end when we came out of the loop. Remember, we are just trying to write a program, and I am speaking along with what I'm doing. So, you know, this is how you basically speak and write a program in LabVIEW. So the speed at the end of the loop, at the end of the while loop, if this speed is less than minus five, because it's negative, and if this statement is true, then you have crash landed. So I wanna tell the user that. So I'll just write some message, create a string constant. Oops. You have crash landed. That's what I wanted. That's what I want to appear at the end. All right. Oops, you have crash landed. And we don't want any other response from the user other than constants. Okay, whatever. I mean, okay. I will improve, something like this, right? This is what user will press, and that's it. And now, so if that happens, if this is true, then this message will execute, like this part of the program will execute, and it will say that you crash landed. And if this is false, then the landing is right, because see, the loop will come out of the loop only when there are more parameters, we'll not go into it, but let us assume that if it is wrong, then I can simply copy this, control C, control V in false, right? If it is false, that means you have succeeded. So I want to say, all right, congratulations, right? Something like that. You won. And user will say, okay, great, thanks. So let us see if we, so you know, there was a ready-made program, we just edited it, we added the dialog box at the end. The point that I'm trying to make here is, because LabVIEW is meant to have your instrument, and instruments are supposed to be interactive, you know, your experiment, your facility, your setup, and that setup needs to be interactive. You can have this sort of interactive features in the program, and let us see if this works or not, right? We have just edited a program. Now let us crash land and see what it shows. Let us crash land, simply let it fall. So you're just free falling on the moon surface, and yeah, 1,000 feet, and boom. So oops, you crash landed, right? So this is what we edited, like this is what we added in the program. So, you know, now you can imagine how easy to make it interactive, make your program interacting, look like the professional program. This is how a professional program would look like typically. Okay, I'll improve. That's it. So, you know, I just added one dialog box at the end. I compared the values. I compared the final speed with the desired speed limit. And if my final speed is more than the desired, you can also take a, you know, round. I mean, you can take the absolute value of 5 and then compare it that if the speed is greater than 5 or not. That's just a matter of mathematics. So, you know, you can then compare. And if this turns out to be true, which means if the speed at the end of the loop was greater than 5, but it was falling, so less than minus 5, then it was a crash land. And if it was false, then you assume that it is a you know, successful landing. So you can simply add the dialog box like this. Now we will make some more programs. We'll go to the PPT. But before we go to the PPT, I want you to see one more nice video just to emphasize upon the fact that, you know, the LabVIEW is not a programming language like Fortran or C or Origin, where you can simply, you know, make some logical program. LabVIEW is basically designed for interfacing, for handling instruments, for talking to instruments. And today, you know, our emphasis will be more on, we'll start with some simple programming, but our emphasis will be more on talking to instruments. And to just, you know, kind of emphasize upon that, I want you to see one very nice, my favorite video actually, which is a student project, the students of Texas A&M. You know, their idea, their goal was to use the vision, NI vision. I mean, basically image processing. You take a picture, high-speed photographs, and process the information out of the photographs and take decisions and make your robots move or make your instruments move accordingly, right? So the decisions of movements of your robot will be taken based on some images, which are live images. So it's basically the very preliminary part of robotics, but it's not about robot, it's about an industrial application. So I'll show you that video. I am not very sure whether you will be able to hear the sound as well or not. Let us see. Yeah, so this is the project. It's basically Texas A&M. It's a small video, 4 minutes, so I want you guys to see it, and I'll give the commentary if the sound is not available. Can you hear the sound?
No, sir.
No, right? Okay. Just a second. Okay. So yeah, you will be able to at least see the captions.
Sir, actually, we are able to hear. Maybe you can increase
Great.
The volume or something.
Great. Yeah. Then I'll not be requiring to explain them.
But sir, the voice is very slow. It is hardly audible.
I'll explain. Anyway, the captions are there.
This demonstration, we've taken the compact vision system, compact PO, built a machine that can sort different size ball bearings on the fly. House is on the fly, literally. The machine we have here is looked with all the different size budgets of 16.
All right. Primary uses. Oops. Whatever.
Compact vision system. Compact Rio. House is on the fly. He means literally.
All right, so you know there are ball bearings, and there are three different sizes of the ball bearing which are very close to each other. Like visibly, it's very difficult to even identify, although you know, you can if you take it in hand, you can identify, but it's very close. And what it does is the ball bearings are just rotating, and when it is in air, the camera will take a picture of it. From the picture, it is calibrated, so from the picture it will find out the diameter of it. There are three different diameter possibles. Depending on the diameter, the ball will be diverted to one of the collectors. So there are three collectors for three different sizes. It's basically sorting. You're sorting the balls of different sizes into different three collectors, and the size, the decision is taken when it is in the air, and by the time, so it's like about, you know, a couple of feet down. So it, a picture will be taken, a photo will be taken here, and by the time it hits the ground, so there's a table there which is rotatable. So by the time it hits that, the decision is taken on the size of this from the diameter, and based on that, the ground, the table is adjusted so that it bounces and goes to the collector, right, whichever is the right collector for this size. So that's what it is. Yeah. So, you know, this video basically talks about the speed with which you can do the image processing in LabVIEW and the precision of your FPGA based system. So you see, this is like a very simple LabVIEW program and some LabVIEW hardwares, like some FPGA based hardware. FPGA is a very, I mean, FPGA is basically a digital breadboard. You can basically, you have all the gates. It is like field programmable gate array, all the gates, NAND gates mostly. You can design these gates with some softwares. There are softwares available. LabVIEW FPGA software is also available. So in LabVIEW, you can design this, you know, FPGA and make a circuit, an IC, basically integrated circuit for your application, which is a custom designed IC. So basically you don't have to buy or purchase an IC. You can make your own IC that can do the, you know, servo drive or intelligent image processing and a lot of other things. So all these basic softwares are used to make a device like this. It's kind of a demo version, but you know what I wanted to emphasize upon is the fact that there are real-time applications in industries where this is routinely used in experiments as well, like even in CERN or the LIGO or such huge multinational experiments have lots of event controls, a lot of instrumentation controls is done using LabVIEW. So with this, let us, you know, start making some simple program and understand how we can make them from the PPT where we stopped last time. Yeah, so we saw that there is a front panel and there's a block diagram. The front panel is basically the front panel of instruments where all the controls and indicators and displays and LEDs and graphs and everything is there. The block diagram is its heart. I mean, it's the internal wiring of the front panel where you can connect the wires in some logical way. to execute the program, right? So all the tools related to programming are available in the block diagram, like loops and structures and decision making devices and timing devices, and all those things are there in the block diagram. And the front panel has all the controls and indicators and graphs and displays. Right. Now, the control palette depends on where you open it. So when you open it in front panel, you have all those controls. We saw these controls yesterday, numerical controls, buttons, text controls, indicators, the graph, the meter, the gauges, and the sliders, and all those things are available on the front panel. If you open it in block diagram, then the mathematical tools, data processing, signal processing tools are available. You can see we will go through some of these, which are useful very frequently. So all mathematics tools, all signal processing tools, data communication tools, connectivities, express VIs, everything is available on the function palette in the block diagram. So when you right click on the block diagram, you get access to this features or these functions. Then there is a status toolbar. So when you open the lab view, I'll show you. So when you open any program, like you can open a new VI, simple new VI, then there's a tool palette here. The button here is run. After writing the entire program, all I have to do is run the program and it executes it once. It executes it once. So the entire program will be executed one. For example, if I have a program that just is a toggle switch, maybe a switch like this, and an LED. Like this. Then depending on the situation, so I have one control and one indicator, and I'll just connect them. So I've got it here. All right, so I've connected them. So now the switch is controlling my LED. If the switch is on, the LED will be on. If the switch is off, LED will be off. When I run the program, right? Currently the switch is on or off? Abhi kya hai? Switch on hai ki off hai?
In off condition, sir.
Switch is off, right? Okay, so switch is off, so LED should not glow when I run the program. Okay, it did not glow, right? Suppose I turn on the switch. Now the switch is on, the LED should glow, right? So when I press this arrow, it runs program once. It runs program once. And depending on the input, the output is changed. So if it is on, I run it, it remains on. If it is off, I run it, it goes off, and so on. I can also change the color of the LED. If I want it to be a red LED, I can simply go to the right, properties, and change it to red or blue or whatever color I want, right? I don't have to grow a gallium nitride to make it blue LED. I can simply, blue LED got the Nobel Prize recently, right? So yeah, like something like this. When it is on, this should be the color. And when it is off, maybe this should be the color. Okay, something like this. Yeah. Okay. So I can change the colors and do whatever I want to do. But it runs once. Suppose I want to continuously run and see what happens. This is continuous run. Run continuously. So the next button is run continuously. If I press it, now it is continuously running. So one time, two time, three time. Who decides the speed of running? Your Windows, your OS. Right, so your OS will decide how fast this program is running, but it is basically continuously running to the maximum of the capacity of LabVIEW. So now if I change it, it will change in real time. Right. Because program is continuously running and the input output are continuously updated. You can also do this by making it a loop, as we did it yesterday. We can simply make a loop, a while loop, create control. And now this stop button will decide how long it will keep running, right? So now I don't have to run it continuously. Now I run it once, but the program has a loop and that loop will run continuously until I stop it from here. So it keeps updating the input and output real time until I stop it, right? And then the program is now over. So this, okay, I'll show you. This button is run. This is continuously run. This is abort. Like during the program, when it was running, you want to execute, like you want to abort the execution, you can abort from here. The program will stop wherever it was. This is kind of abort button, right? Just like abort button. Then this part is just for display, like you are writing something, so text, like you want to change the size of the text and font and style, justify, bold, color, you know, different types of fonts. So this is kind of cosmetic things. 15 point application font, right? Then this is kind of alignment, align object. So you can align the objects side by side, because remember, you are making an instrument and instrument needs different buttons. So depending on how many buttons you want, how many switches and controls and displays and LEDs you want to align them side by side. So these are three, this is again cosmetics, like how good you want it to be looking. And reorder, so you want to move forward, move backward. These are just simple controls which just, you know, affect the look of your program. All right, so this is a tool, various tools available for front panel. Similarly, on block diagram, there are some interesting tools. So we'll go to the block diagram from Windows. I can just go to show block diagram, or I can double click on any of the instrument and it'll go to the block diagram, right? So here now I'm in the block diagram. From block diagram also, I can run the program. I can run it continuously. I can abort the execution. I can pause the execution, right? But then there are some very interesting features. For example, a lamp. Now, what does lamp do? Lamp highlights the execution. So it's like it slows down the execution and exactly shows me where the data is and how the data are moving. So suppose I have, okay, for example, in this case, if I turn on the lamp and then run the program will run slowly. So you see the true is there. This true is coming and going to the LED. If I change during the program, now it'll be false, right? So the false is going. Basically, it slows down the execution. And so basically, every time in every iteration, this goes here, this goes here, this goes here, this goes here. And you can see the data flowing over the wire, right? So this is basically highlighting the execution. This is one of the very important features that allows you to debug a program. Because when you have written a program and then there is a bug, there's some error, some logical error. Syntax errors are very easy to find in this. Syntax errors are almost impossible to happen, right? That syntax error, a very common feature for C or Fortran or those sort of text-based programs. For graphical program, syntax errors are very unlikely, because you know you cannot in fact connect the different types of wires. For example, this is an integer, right? I is an integer. The blue color indicates that it is an integer. Green color indicates that it is a boolean. So boolean is a different data type. Integer is a different data type. I cannot connect these two wires. It will show a broken wire. It says that this is not possible. This cannot happen. This doesn't make sense, right? So this would be a syntax error in other programming language. You change the data type, or you wrote a wrong command or something like that. This is very unlikely to happen here. But the logical errors can happen, and get rid of those logical bugs, logical errors, you can highlight the execution and run the program in slow motion. So this is one feature which allows you to debug very efficiently. Then retain wire values. This is a prob. You know, in C program or in Fortran or in, you know, whatever programming language you're using, suppose sometimes you are debugging and after three or four lines of code, you want to have a prob. So you basically, suppose you have a variable, you display the value of that variable after three or four lines, and then keep updating that value and displaying it after every three, four lines, right? So that is basically you are probing the value internally during the program. That can be done by simply putting the prob here. I mean, I can put a prob here. So when I turn it on, it retains the wire value. So when I execute, it tells me what value is running on this wire, right? So that is basically retaining the wire during the program. Yeah, so here it is. So it is one. One means true, current, right? So that retains the value. It's false here. Okay, so this is a prob that tells me what value it has here on the wire when the program is running. So these are all debugging tools. Okay, and then skip a step, right? So it's like you can also execute the program stepwise. You know, so when you do this, first step is executed, next step, third step. So you can do the stepwise execution. So all these are, so you know, mostly these tools on the block diagram are debugging tool. The tools which are, you know, there are equivalent tools available in C program. You can do a stepwise execution, one instruction at a time. Similarly, this one have one instruction at a time, like one step at a time. So you it keeps executing one step at a time. You can skip the step. You can simply go to the last step and so on. All right. So these tools are mostly for debugging. Again, some cosmetic tools like changing the size of this and color of this and those things, that something like this. So these are cosmetic tools. And then there is one very important feature, which is like clean up the diagram. So it happens many a times that when you're making the program, because you are just quickly connecting the wires, it looks messy, right? That happens when you are making the electronic circuit as well. If you are connecting the wires in electronic circuit, it might happen that you've taken a very long wire, and so it is jumping from one terminal to the other terminal with a long tail and something like this. So you want to clean up such diagrams. For example, maine yahan se ye wire aise connect kar diya hai. Instead of this, I just connected this wire like this. Right. It is a very long program, very complicated program. And I just, you know, while making the program, I was trying to understand the logic. So I just connected the wires wherever and however they could connect. But now I finally have completed the program. The errors are gone. Now I want it to look good. Right. And also to be able to understand the program, it is easy and better to have these wires properly arranged. Right. So all I have to do is right click on the wire and clean up the wire. Right. So that will just, you know, make the wire go with the shortest path. Or I can simply do this, clean up the program. Everything is now compact, short, and simple, right? So this is all cosmetic tools here on the right hand side. The left hand side are all debugging tools, which are very important, and we will go to them again as and when we require. So run button, continuous run button, abort execution. These are execution tools. Then highlighting button, written wire values, and step function buttons. These are debugging tools. All right, and let's move further. So let us see some of these tools one by one. Tools can mainly be divided into four parts according to their roles: data input output, functions, loops, and decision making tools. Any programming language, you know, you take any programming language, these are the major categories of the functions or the tools available in any programming language. For example, if you take C, there are variables which are for data input output, right? The variables would allow you to take the data in or display the data out. So there are variables, then there are functions, the mathematical, arithmetic, logical functions, right? You can add, you can subtract, you can find the factorial, you can. So there are mathematical functions available. You use the libraries, different libraries for mathematical functions, math.h if it is C. Then there are loops. Actually, loops is a very limited term. The general term would be branching, right? The tools which are for branching. So, you know, the execution needs some sort of branching. All the decision makings are basically in any programming language, all the way from the microprocessor based assembly level program to the high end program like CPP and VB and all. There are instructions which allows you to branch the execution. Matlab, there are, you know, multiple ways you can go back to the different instructions, and those are the branching instructions, right? So case structures, loops, then if else. Right, these are all branching instructions. These branching instructions are divided in LabVIEW in two major parts. Ones are structures, for example, loops. And then there are some decision-making tools, which, I mean, there are one or two very interesting and very important tools, which I will explain, and we'll probably use them in our programs, small programs. So data I/O, functions. Functions are mathematic, arithmetic, and signal processing functions, like Fourier transform and all those. Loops are the for loops, while loops, and some other structures. And then decision making tools like case structures and if else and all. So these are the four major components. Let us see data I/O. Now data I/Os, you know, basically are controls and indicators on the front panel. They can be numeric, they can be Boolean, they can be array and matrices. And then there are some data decorations like tab controls and arrows, and then finally files. So these are different ways in which you can feed the data into a program or extract the information out of the program. The information or the data can be numeric data. So there are numeric controls like this, and then there are numeric indicators. They can be Boolean data. So switches and LEDs are Boolean data. Array and matrices, they are basically numeric or any type. I mean, the array and matrices are basically types of data. They can be, I mean, of course, I can have an array of numeric data. I can have array of Boolean data as well. I can have a matrix of numeric values. I can have matrix of Boolean values as well. So arrays and matrices are of different types, but they are used, I mean, they are available in different sort of controls. Decorations we will ignore. And file IOs, I can read a file or I can write to the file. So these are different controls and indicators which are available. Okay, then there are charts. Now charts are very interesting. Like waveform chart is especially a numeric indicator that can display a history of values. Chart updates with each individual point it receives. And okay, so let me show you one simple chart. I think we made it yesterday, right? So for example, I'll take any blank VI. Graph indicator, this is a chart, right? Now this is a chart. Let us take a random value generator. Okay, this is a random number generator. This is simple random number generator. There are in math tool, there are more complicated random number. I mean, there are other algorithms also available. So you can use certain specific algorithm to generate a random value, but this is a standard random value generator. And let us just generate this random value and display it on chart, right? So if I do it, it will just show one data point. Okay, there is no data point here because I am not pointing. I'm just pointing it as a point. I can have it as a point as well. Okay, something like this. Yeah. Okay. So because I am running it only once, it will be a center. But then, yeah. See, these are random values. Huh? I'm generating random values. And as usual, like for any other programming language, this is a random number generator between 0 and 1. So you can simply scale it up to any values. If I run it continuously, it'll keep generating the random values between 0 and 1. Right? Now you can say that this is a pseudo random value. This is not actually random value. So it depends on what algorithms we use to generate a random value. There are various algorithms available, but this is a standard ready-made tools which can generate random values, and I'm just plotting them on a chart, right? I can also put it in a while loop and run it. All right. So it is generating random value, and I can stop wherever I want. So this is a chart, and chart basically creates or records the history of data. I can also start it from zero every time. There are all features available in the properties. We can go to the properties and then, you know, play with the displays, play with how we want to represent it and all. I can change the scale of the graph. I mean, I can simply go to this and say that instead of 0 and 1, I want to see between, let us say, -5 to +5. Sorry, +5 or -5. Scales will be changed accordingly. It will be auto scale, so it will automatically change to 0 and 1 if I don't do anything. So I'll just remove the auto scale Y. So now it will not auto scale and it will show me the random values between 0 and 1 on this scale, right? So all these plug and play things are there, which helps us make the program look good because this is going to be an instrument. And finally, let's go ahead and see some more features. So this is chart. This is a special type of display available. The XY graph is also available. Normal graph is also available with time and so on. Okay. The graphs are typically the values displayed graphically. Again, same random number, 0 and 1. I'll show one interesting things here later. And then file IO. It's like simple. You can read a file or you can write to file. There are LVM files which are specific LabVIEW measurement files. Which has all the headers and timestamp and everything inbuilt. But you can have simple text file also. You can write it to a text file. You can write it to any form of file. You can create an Excel sheet, spreadsheet. All sort of files are available. Binary files. Those things are there. I mean, you just define. You can define the type of the file in this icon itself, and it will make a text file or a spreadsheet or whatever you want. Okay. Let us see some functions. Functions are very simple. As I said yesterday, we saw the multiplied addition, subtraction, those functions are there. Then there are standard VIs, and then there are express VIs. So the functions can be divided into three parts: normal mathematical functions, which are basic functions, typically yellow; standard VIs, which are modularized VIs customized by users. Some people have prepared these VIs, and they are available as functions to use. And then there are express VIs. I will explain the difference between these three. So when I go to any blank file, when I right click, see, there are in any of them, like, okay, I'll just, for example, in mathematics, there are some basic functions like add, subtract, multiply, divide, and so on. Yesterday we saw this math constant as well. But then there are some statistical tools like finding mean, right? Then finding standard deviation and variance, finding the measure of spread, and different covariance and RMS and MSE and histograms. These are the mathematical tools which are, you know, I can pick it. Let us say we want to find median. So I can pick it. It has an X input, and it generates the median and the error, if any, in finding the median, right? So this is also a mathematical tool available. This is basic tools because it's yellow. But then there are some files, for example. Yes, go. Yeah, for example, see, these are convert strain gauge reading, convert thermistor reading. These are actually dot VI. If you put the cursor on this, it says convert thermistor reading dot VI, which means it is actually a program made by someone. In C, you can, you know, call a function, right? You can call a function that can be a program written by someone else. It has some well-defined inputs and outputs. So if you want to take that input and generate an output based on their program, you can simply call a function. Similarly, there are lots of programs written by users, and some of the programs which are of general purpose use, they just update it in the next version. So when the LabVIEW new version is available, they will update a lot of such VIs and put them, make them the part of their default version. So now they are available. For example, scaling, convert strain gauge, or I'll take something which is very common to you. Convert thermistor reading. So this is a VI. Now, how does it matter? I mean, what do I mean when I say this is a VI? It is actually a program written by someone. Suppose I want to change the program which is written by someone. All I have to do is double click on it. See, the program is open now, right? It is actually an entire VI in itself. It is designed by someone, written by someone. But now that LabVIEW has incorporated it in the basic version, they make it look very basic. So they have written all the instructions, comments, basically all comments, that what does this VI do, what should be the input, what should be the output, and what are the inputs, what are the output. And you can also go to the block diagram and change it if you want. Suppose I want to have a slightly different equation for my calibration, I can change it into their program and then save it. So I can call my own program as a function, it's called sub VI. I can call a sub VI and use it in it. I can use a ready-made VI provided by LabVIEW, change it the way I want into the equation, into the even logic I can change and use it, right? So this is a VI which I'm calling. So I can have a basic function like this. Now, this is a basic function. This is a VI. So that yellow color will not be there. And these are some functions, mathematical functions available that for direct use. And then finally, there is something called express VI. So a basic function does not have a code. For example, this random number generator, even if I double click, nothing will open. This is a very fundamental feature, and it doesn't have a code available for me to change. This is a VI for which I can change the code. I can double click on it, go to the block diagram of it, and change it. So there is a VI for which the code is available for me to change, to play with, right? There are some basic functions. And finally, there are express VIs. Express VIs are kind of, VIs for learning, like for learner, beginner. Suppose there are some features, particularly, for example, if you go to measurement IO, and if we go to, suppose we are doing spectroscopy, and I want to kind of, let us go to scope. So express block, right? Express VIs are have this sort of visuals where you have a blue block around it. This is an express block, a VI made by someone else, but it is an interacting VI. It's like I can pick it, place it, and that will open a window which will ask me a lot of things to configure this VI. So this is a tool which I can configure, right? So as soon as I put it, it is now initializing. It will ask me, what do you want to do with this scope? So it's an Express VI means, you know, it is a VI made by LabVIEW engineers for beginners. So I can feed all the things, and then this will act like an oscilloscope for me, right? What do I want to do? What are the triggers? What are the advanced configuration? You know, auto stop rakhna hai ki nahi rakhna, kitni channel, 1 or 2, 0 or 1, dono channel use karni hai, range kya rakhni hai, DC coupling hai, AC coupling hai. All these things are, you know, interacting. Then I can run it once, I can run it, I can check whether it is working or not. Once I am happy, I can say okay. And now that VI is prepared, built, it has all the inputs depending on what I configured, all the outputs, and I can use it in my program. I can connect the wires to it like this. Like this, right? So now it is a tool for me. I can wire it and use it. But I can double click on it, go to the configuration and change the configuration and so on. I can make the channel 0 and 1 gayab kar sakta hu main usko, ground kya karna hai, kitna impedance lena hai, bandwidth kya rakhna hai, all I can, you know, play with, and the VI will change itself. So this is called Express VI, Normal VI, and Fundamental Functions. These are the three major categories of functions available in LabVIEW: the Express VI, Normal VIs, and the fundamental functions like addition, subtraction, and so on. Okay. Then there are loops. Okay, while loop and for loop. While loop we have been using a lot, so I'll not go into that, but we'll show you the for loop. By the way, since you know we have been doing it, let me show you one nice example of how we can use a sub VI. I think sub VI will come later. I'll do it then. Suppose I want to use a while for loop, right? So I can go into the structures and select a for loop. Anything within this will be running iteratively in a for loop. How many times for I want the loop to run, I can create a right, I can right click and create a control over here. So on the front panel, this is the number of times the loop will run. If I say this will run for 10 times, the loop will run for 10 times. The I is the current iteration. So it starts from 0, and every iteration it increments itself by 1. In C program we write, right, I plus 0, I plus plus. If you have done the C program, for loop, for n is less than equal to, for I is less than equal to 5, I starts from 0 and I keeps incrementing itself by 1. We start the loop like that, right? We define the loop, we define the iteration parameters and put a condition in the beginning. Here you can just simply say how many times it wants you want to run it. This can be simply a number or it can be a condition. It can be, suppose if it is a spectroscopy, I say what is the starting wavelength? Control and drag, so it copies it. I can say what is the final wavelength. And I ask what is the step size. I'm doing a spectroscopy experiment. I say what is the step size. And then I put an equation which is like final wavelength minus starting wavelength divided by step size will be the number of times the loop will run, right? So if my starting wavelength is 500, final wavelength is 600, and step size is 5 nanometer, then I want to run it for 20 times, 600 minus 500. So it's like I can have plus 1 also, so I can, because you know, it will start, I want the final and last wavelength also as a part of my data, so I can increment it to 1. First I need to round it, because you know the division could be a fractional value, so I can round to the nearest or round to the maximum one, round to the upper infinity or lower infinity. I can let, okay, round to the nearest one, and then I can increment it. I can make plus 1, because you know I want the last and the first one as a part of my data. So control Z, increment. Okay, so now the, if the starting wavelength is, let us say 500, final wavelength is 600. This is a typical spectroscopy run I might take. Step size is, let us say, 10 nanometer. Okay, this could be nanometer. I can write the unit here. Okay, and then, you know, this decides, so 600 minus 500 is 100 divided by 10. So 10 plus 1 is 11. So this loop will run for 11 times, right? And what do I want to do with this loop? Every time I want to take some measurements, so I'll just read some data. But for now, I just want to display the current iteration. So create an indicator, right? So this shows the current iteration, right? What is the current iteration? What will happen if I run this program? Can someone tell me what will happen if I run this program? Like if I press this button here, what should I see in this numeric value? Can someone guess?
I think values at regular intervals of 10, 105, 10, 520, something like that.
Okay, good try, but no, because you know I have not connected it to anything, right? It is just numeric value which displays the current iteration. So it'll start from zero and every time it'll keep incrementing. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It'll run for 11 times. So it'll start from zero and will go up to 11. Oh, sorry, go up to 10, 0 to 10. So there are 11, right?
Okay.
But I will not be able to see it. Why? Because it runs so fast, like program runs so fast that it will simply show me the last value. So if I run it now, boom, 10, right? Because 10 is the last value when the program stopped. It ran for 11 times and it incremented slowly, but then, you know, I could not see it because it went so fast. If I want to show it, what I have to do is either I should turn on the highlighting so that now I can see the data. Now you can see the data floating. This will start from 500, this will start from 600. So this will be 100. 100 divided by 10 will make it 10. Then it'll be rounded to 10, then plus 1, 11. So 11 will come here. Then this will be 0, 1, 2. You will keep seeing it slowly like this. So you see things are changing here. And same thing also changes on the front panel. 9, 10, and stop. Right? So you basically run the program in slow motion when you turn on the highlighting. If you don't want to do that, I'm turning off the highlight. I want to run it at the real time. But because I want to see it, suppose you are doing the spectroscopy, you are using a monochromator. I'll explain what monochromator is probably in the next class or so. But suppose you're dealing with the monochromator, it is basically some motor which is rotating a grating and that changes the wavelength of light. Now, those mechanical motions are very slow, right? So your program cannot run like this. You change one step, then stop there, let the light stabilize, then let the photocurrent develop. That may also take some time. There's a capacitor, internal capacitor, so it takes maybe a few milliseconds to develop the photocurrent. And then you read it using Locking amplifier, maybe 10 times, take an average of it, right? So all this will take some time and you cannot run a program like this. So you might want to slow it down. So that can be conditional slowdown or that can be simple fixed time. I can say that, all right, I want to wait for the light to stabilize to constant value, which is not changing plus or minus 0.5% of the actual value or something like that. I can put similar condition, or I can put the fixed value of time by going into this clock icon and wait for millisecond. So I'll say, okay, every iteration should wait for 1000 milliseconds, which is 1 second, right? It is the default time unit is millisecond. So 1000 milliseconds it will wait. Now I'm not turning on the highlight, but when I run this program, the iteration will run at 1 second each. So after every iteration, there'll be a delay of 1 second and you will not be able to see the data flowing because the highlighter is off, but the data will be updated at every 1 second. Every second, yeah. because I have put a time delay in between, right? So you can assume as if I have put a time delay in C loop, in a for loop in C program. This is it. All right, so this is a for loop runs. A while loop will not have this end because we don't tell it in advance how many times you want to run, but there'll be a condition on the bottom corner and you can stop, or you can also change that condition. For example, if I take a while loop, right, so you can have a create control. Now, what do you want to do? You want to stop when it is true, or you want to continue if it is true? So it'll continue until it is true, and then it stops when it becomes false, right? So you can change that as well. Continue if true. So that will have a different logic. So logic will change. That also has an I, which is a current iteration, but that will not have this thing, the N. Okay. Now suppose what Jaimin said, you know, what it will show. If I want to show that, the current wavelength, I'll have to do some math. How do I do some math? All I have to do is this. The step size. Multiplied by I. Plus the starting wavelength, right? Okay. And now I can make another indicator. Okay. This can be current wavelength in nanometer. So you see, now this one will show me the current wavelength in nanometer. This is showing me the current iteration. If I run it, every second it will update. 0th iteration, it is 500, 510, 520, 530, 540, 550, 560, 570, 580, 590, then 600, stop. Right? So you see now, I mean, I'm trying to build up a very simple spectroscopy experiment where I'm changing the wavelength every second and measuring the photocurrent. So there will be some measurement condition here. I'll go to the measurement IO and put a DAQ max and put some read voltage or something like this, right? I'll read about voltage using this, and I'll tell which channel I have connected my photodetector to, and that will just measure the photocurrent. I can convert it using the photo responsivity to the intensity of light, and then I can draw a graph. Let us say current iteration versus current wavelength is our current wavelength, and let us say our value is some random number. I can generate a random number, or I can take an incrementing random number. What I can do is I can multiply the current iteration with some random number. So there'll be incrementing random value. Okay, and this is my y. Let us say this is my y. This is my x, this is my y, and I want to draw a graph of it, right? So what I'll do is I'll go to the Brook diagram, take a graph, xy graph to start with, put somewhere. Now this is an express vi, you see? So I can take it inside because I want to update it every time. So I'll take x, current wavelength, Y, some value which I have measured, right? Currently I'm generating it through random number, but some incrementing value which I'm measuring, let us say. And now, okay, I don't want to clear the data every time. I want to retain the data at every iteration. So, okay. This will be an XY graph where X-axis will be from 500 to 600. Y-axis will be some random values multiplied by 0, 1, 2, 3. So it will be incrementing random value. Yeah, something like that. Let us see what we get. Like something like this. If you fit it linearly, there'll be a linear. I mean, this ideally this should be a linear line from 0 to 10, but because it's a random number, 500 to 600, and this turn out to be 0 to some random values, right? So this is how we draw the graph. I can change the color of the graph. I can have multiple plots in it. I can make more plots. I can simply stretch it and have more x and y values going in. I can enable, disable. There are a lot of things which you can do, which will not go into detail. But I can add x, as many x as I want, as many y as I want on this graph. So this is very simple graph. अच्छा ये बहुत गंदा सा लग रहा है, लंबा लंबा. What I can do is I can select and झाड़ू मार दो. ठीक है. So this is a typical program of XY graph. I generated random number and let's go ahead in our presentation. It's 12:21. At what time are we supposed? 12:06. We will stop at 12:30, right? Alright. So this is a while loop. This is a for loop. As I say, while loop is a fan. It keeps running until I turn off the switch, right? For loop is a fan where I tell, run 10 times. So for loop has n, which is the number I will tell in advance how many times the loop will run. The while loop, I don't tell it how many times it will run. It'll just stop when some condition is met. Now there are some decision-making tools. For example, case structure. We took an example of case structure. True and false, right? For example, in that case, when we were playing with that moon landing game, we said that if the condition is true, which means if the speed with which I collided, I fell down on the ground, was less than -5, which means greater than 5 meters per second speed, then it was a crash landing, and I just displayed a message, right? So when something is true, do this. When something is not true, do that. So it can be the case structure could be a true false case structure. Okay, I'm tampering with some VI, but yeah, case structure, it is in structure. So I can have the case structure as a Boolean case structure, which means true and false, only two cases, a true and false, right? Or I can also have an number here. So that can be a ring structure. For example, there can be value between, so it's like, aapne aisa dekha hoga ki press any button between 0 and 9, 0 to 9. Press any button between 0 to 9. Jab aap customer care ko phone karte ho, ye aapko bahut karwate hai. Press 5 if you want to listen in Hindi, and press 6 if you want to listen in English, and so on. So there you have multiple choices, multiple options. You can have like 0 to whatever number you want. I can simply, like for example, this one. I can have some numerical number n. Connect to it, simple. Yeah. Now it becomes 0 is default. I can have 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Depending on which number I feed here, that case will be selected. I can add as many cases as I want. Add case after. So 0 1 2 0 1 2 3, something like this, right? So depending on the value I feed here, that number of case will be executed, right? So let us display that what case are you running. So we go to that dialog box, only one button dialog, simple. Now, you are in case, and then I want to write what case it is, right? So now the problem is, this is a text. The pink color indicates that it is a text, and I want to merge two text lines. So what I'll do is I'll convert the number also in a text. I can convert number into text in a multiple way. Text still to byte. Or it'll be in string length over here. Yeah. Format into string. So this is the number, and I can tell what is the width I want. So this is now the number, same number, but it is a decimal integer string. I want to merge this tool. Like I so this joins the two string values, and then this is the message. I'll say okay. I'm showing how I can make simple programs, right? So this is a repetition, but yeah. So you are in case number so and so. Now, whatever is the value of n, it will show me. Okay. Remove unnecessary parts like this. Or suppose I don't want to delete it because I have made this program. I don't want to delete it. But right now, I don't want to utilize this program. There is something called disable that part of the program. I'll have to find where it is. You can disable diagram, so you can disable that part of the diagram. Anyways, that we'll find out, but for now we can simply delete this part. Also, we can, in case if we cannot find it, we can search it from the help menu, but that will take time, so I'm not doing it now. Anyways, what I can do is I can simply take this part, Control X, File, New VI, Control C, so that I don't lose this part. Now, okay, let's run this program. Whatever is the value here, let us say 2, then press it. You are in case 2, right? Humne kya kiya tha? You are in case tha, aur phir jo bhi number tha, usko string mein convert karke add kar diya tha. So whatever is the number here, that case is being executed. I am trying to give you an example. Yes, C language bhi jab sikhte hai, ya Fortran jab sikhte hai, to is tarah ke example hum lete hai, you know, you are in case so and so. So this can be, now, achha, yahan pe kisi ne 9 kar diya to, तो 9 का तो ऑप्शन ही नहीं है क्योंकि 9 तो यहां है ही नहीं तो इन दैट केस डिफॉल्ट विल बी रनिंग 0 इज डिफॉल्ट और इट माइट जस्ट से दैट देयर इज एन एरर या ओके बिकॉज़ वी आर गिविंग इट एज अ डिफॉल्ट सो यू आर इन केस 9 ओके या इट रन डिफॉल्ट बट बिकॉज़ यू नो यहां पे 9 था वो 9 वैल्यू उसने डिफॉल्ट में से लिया राइट यही हम यहां से दे रहे हैं ना इसलिए सो बट Now to not let that happen, generally क्या करते हैं ऐसे इसको हम ring में convert कर देते हैं. We convert it into a ring. Anyways, we'll show it later. I'll check it. Okay, we can convert it into ring so that now, you know, only those 0 to 4 or 0 to 3, whichever are the valid values, will be available. And we will not be writing here, but we will choosing it from the options. Right? So it's like just a drop-down menu. Hota hai, waisa drop-down menu yahan aa jayega, and then we will be able to see only those things. So. Yeah, so here it is now. Okay, so I can add number of items which I want to like insert. 0, 1, 2, and so on. Okay, so now it could be either 0, 1, or 2, right? I cannot have any other value here, so that prevents from those errors. So we can, you know, choose different types of case structures. This is just like if else or the case structure in your normal C program, but it's just graphical. You can insert the diagram into relative case and run it. Okay, let's move further in our PPT. Okay, one more decision making tool is this one, which is very important. I'll show you. This one. So what it does, it's very simple. You know, it takes true or false here, and it passes one of these two input to the output. So it's like selected output. It's kind of a multiplexer, a very simple multiplexer, where a true will allow the upper part to pass to the output. The false will allow the lower part. For example, यहाँ पे मैंने कर दिया create constant करके 0 की जगह मैं कर देता हूँ 5. Alright. And here I'm making 10. Some numbers, just basic number. This can be text. This can be whatever you want. And create a control here that can be true or false. This can be, instead of control, this can be some conditions depending on some variable values or so. And then you create an indicator here. Okay. So if this is true, the 5 will appear here. If this is false, 10 will appear here, right? So I'm selecting between the two. Okay, this is false, so it was 10. 5, 10, 5, 10. Okay, so it is selecting between the two input. Now, this is very important feature. Like when you're making a program, many a times you need to take this such steps where depending on some conditions being true or false, you want one of the two inputs to go to the output, right? So this is a very common feature you use again and again when you're making some instruments, virtual instruments using LabVIEW. This is what is shown here. Yeah. Okay. Then the data types, as I said, the color indicates what data type it is. For example, the green means Boolean. Double precision number is orange. Integer number is blue. Then there are complex numbers, which are also orange. The array are thicker wires. Two-dimensional array are like double line wires. A matrix is shown as like matrices. There are lots of matrices on the wire. So that shows that it is a matrix data. String is pink. Then clusters could be of different types. Cluster means different types of data put together and passed in a single wire. It's like a cable, multi-wired cable, multi-core cable. Error cluster is also a cluster, so it's just like cluster. And then dynamic data, the continuously changing data are shown like this wire. So the wire color and the wire type tells you what type of data is being flowing on that wire, right? So this helps you read the program when you are understanding or debugging it, or even when you are making it. All right. Now, finally, before we stop today, there are some very tricky techniques which are not very common or which are not very analogous to some other programming language like C or so. These are very specific to LabVIEW because it is graphical, right? I mean, since the program is graphical, the language is graphical, there are certain things which are very specific to LabVIEW. And that requires some learning, some extra advanced learning, just two or three things. So I'll just show you those particular things in the next three slides before we stop. Right. Mainly one is data flow programming. The flow of the data is like from left to right, but it depends on how you connect the wire. If your wire is from right to left, the data will flow from right to left also. It's like, so, okay, block diagram execution dependent on the flow of data. Block diagram does not execute left to right. Means it's not that it always goes from left to right. It depends on the wire. If the wire is like from right to left and left to right, it goes on the wire accordingly. It's like electronics, right? Node executes when data is available to all the input terminals. For example, this part will only execute when both the data are available. Similarly, the multiplication will take place only when both these data are available. Right. So the data flow, basically logic race is what is known thing. So to avoid the logic race, it waits for all the data to be available on the inputs. not supply data to all the output terminals when done, and useful to introduce time delay. So many a times, you know, you have to introduce the time delay if you know that the change in data is not exactly same or exactly simultaneous. Anyways, then creating an array is little tricky. I mean, if you want to create an array, I'll show you with an example. There are two ways you can do that. You can suppose you see you want to create an array. Yeah. So one thing you can do is you can go to array constant. Take array constant. Now array constant is like this. Now whatever type of data you put in, that will be the array of that type. For example, if I take a string and take a string constant, put it here, now it becomes a string array, right? I take array constant and take a number like integer number, then it becomes an integer array, right? So what is an array, by the way? Okay, I can also change it to control. So control means I can feed it from the control panel. Now what is array? It has an index and it has a value. So at different index, so I can simply write like this. Okay, so this is a one dimensional array. I can have 1, 2, 5, 41, some random numbers, 15, 0, 2. So this is one dimensional array, and I can play with this array just the way I do it in C or any other programming language. I can index it, I can find out the index and the corresponding value. For example, if this is my array, delete this part. I can go to array panel and I can index array. So this is my array. And whatever index I tell, create control, I'll just create a that number, I mean that member of the array will come out from here. Right. So this is the element at this index. So if I say this is, let us say 2, what should come out when I play here, when I run? What should be the element when index is 2? Tell me what will be the value of in element indicator. Batao. Yes. You play with array, right? I mean, in C or Fortran or any programming language, if you have learned, you do play with array. So yeah, so tell me, you know, this is the array. What I've done is I've told that I want index number 2 pe jo element hai wo mujhe chahiye. So what element will come out here when I run the program? Index number 2 pe kya hai?
Sir, yes? Sir, 5.
Very good. 5. Wonderful. Boom. See, 5. Right. So it's like, because this is 0th element, first element, second element, third element, fourth element, 5 and 6, right? So depending on what index I am telling, you know, it will give me that element. So you can, so this is how you play with the array. But creating an array, I took some time. Like I had to read, why did I put it here? Because I had to read a lot to find out how I create a new array from string or from, it can be a string array as well. All I have to do is just go to the array, take array constant, then go to the string, take a string constant, put it in it. Right. Now I have I can make it control, I can make it whatever I want. Okay, so now this is string array. I can write name, Vipul. Whatever, like Sachin, Tendulkar, and whatever you want. Maybe C.V. Raman. Something like that. Huh? So now, you know, I can use the same program. Instead of this, now I'm getting this array. Now indicate, because you know, output is a name, not the number. So I'll have to change the indicator. Same thing. So 1, it should be Sachin. Something like this. So this is how you plug and play with array. Because it is difficult, it's slightly tricky to make an array. That's why I show it. Also, there's another way of making an array, which we will see. पे, शिफ्ट रजिस्टर पर बाद में आएंगे, पहले दूसरा जो तरीका है उसको मैं दिखा देता हूँ। सपोज suppose this is our program and you see this is my I, right? I is the current iteration now, and this is current wavelength. Let us say suppose I want all these wavelength data out. I can simply connect this. Okay, now if I create indicator, this will be an array, right? And it will tell me all the values, and it will give me all the values out starting from the beginning. So if we do it like thoda delay kam kar dete hain taki 1 second wait na karna pade. Kahan gaya delay? Yeah. 500 kar dete. Right. So if we run this program now, you see, this is a random value generator. Now, so this is the array we have generated, and it gave me all the values out, right? So 500, 510, 20, 30, 40, 50, and it is indexed like this. So this is also how you can generate an array from the loop. Suppose I don't want an array, I want just last value out. All I have to do is disable indexing. Now it is not an array, only the last value comes out, like we did in that moon landing program. So now if I make an indicator, it just is a single value, which is the last value at the end of the loop, right? If I enable the array, enable the indexing by right clicking here, then it becomes an array and all the values come out. See, the wire breaks because this is an individual indicator. Instead of that, I need to now take an array indicator. So I can right click and create, go to array palette, or I can simply create an indicator, and that will be the array indicator. Okay, so this is how you play with data. And finally, before we stop, I just want to show you the shift register. The shift register is very interesting. Sometimes you want the value from previous iteration in a loop to be available in the current iteration. So that can be done by shift register. Suppose I have some loop. I can use the same program. So, you know, this is a loop. Now, suppose I want the previous iteration's wavelength value also in the current iteration, right? So one, I can do it by math, but the other way is, for example, if you want to write a program to find the factorial, you might need the previous value also feeding to the next iteration. So every value should also go to the next iteration as an input. Now, just right click on the edge of this and add shift register. So now, you know, if I give this value, let us say wavelength value here, then the next iteration, it will be available from here. If I create an indicator, you can see that the current value and this is the previous value will be shifted by one iteration. So if I run this, you see there's a difference of one. This was the previous value, this is the current value. Right, so in the current iteration, I can take the input from the previous iteration as well. Basically, I'm feeding over time, right? I'm feeding the data over time. So this is called shift register, which is a very useful tool for writing the sequential programs where you are using some values from the previous iteration in the current iteration. Right, in C, because it is a textual language, or in any other programming language, you know, because it is written upstairs, you can use it later on in the program. But here, because it is a diagram, how do you take something from the previous diagram into the next iteration? You can do it by shift register. All right, so this is shift register. These are some techniques which are not easily intuitive. I mean, these are not very easily comprehensible. So you have to either read or understand. Local variables we will see in the next class before we go for the some demonstrations, right? So we stop here for the lunch. We continue this discussion at 2:30, I think. We started at 11, so 12:30 is okay, I think. Yeah. So we can now continue this discussion at 2:30. What is the time? 2:30, right, ma'am?
Yes, sir. 2:30, sir.
Yeah. Okay, sir. So we'll meet at 2:30 and continue this discussion, and then we will see some demonstration of how do we talk to instruments using LabVIEW, right? I will in front of you only make some small programs Or I can use some ready-made programs, which I already made, some earlier students have made, and demo it for the simplicity. So yeah, we'll continue this discussion at 2:30.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Very informative program. Yes, thank you very much.
Thank you.
So participants, we will meet around 2:30. So please join. And Professor Vipul will continue his lecture.